everyone. So, ghosts can be a terrifying thing. And here are some of my ghost stories and how I've been able to explain my paranormal phenomenon. Firstly, I do not believe in ghosts, but that was not always the case. When I was younger, I used to go over to my gran's house and binge watch a TV show called Most Haunted. A show, by the way, which is terrible to watch as an adult.
It was just before her birthday, before her 14th birthday. She didn't make 14 of years. Keris. The young lady, Keris.
I mean, what is this? Seriously, what is this? The weird thing is that I've seen some very weird ghostly paranormal apparitions and ghost sightings in my life. From actual ghost sightings to, you know, just more horrendous feeling. And some stuff that just affects my dreams. So I'm going to break it down as best I can for you guys and for me, because I'm trying to explain my experiences from a standpoint of an objective, rational view set. So let's break it down. When I watch these ghost shows, like Most Haunted, it's important to keep your objective head on. A common theme that I've seen recurring through a lot of these ghost encounters is when people say that they've just woken up in the middle of the night and that they see something at the foot of their bed.
It felt like someone was taking their two, like, strong arms like this and press them against my chest, so they're pressing me into the bed, but there's no one there.
She woke up and saw a blonde woman standing over her.
This is not a ghost. This is not a ghost. This is sleep paralysis. If you're an old-time subscriber, you'll know the story of sleep paralysis and what it is, but for those of you who are just joining us for the first time, maybe this is your first video of mine, then I'll explain a little bit more in detail. Sleep paralysis is a weird thing that happens to everybody in the night. When you're asleep and you're in a period of sleep called REM, your body's actually paralyzed. And the best theory we have is that your body is kind of protecting itself from acting out its dreams. And this process is called REM atonia when you're asleep. Sometimes you can wake up in the middle of the night and you're still in REM atonia, but then you're awake at the same time, and this is called sleep paralysis. It's a weird stage of you not being able to move, but yet you're still dreaming at the same time. And often people will hallucinate. People will see this, and sometimes people will refer to this as ghosts. Even if you're not in sleep paralysis, you can still have like a fuzzy dreamlike brain. So you can still see something even though you've just woken up. I had one occasion in which I woke up and I still had like a dream brain, so to speak. My friend was staying over my house. I slept on the floor because he had, like, chest issues. So I just slept on the floor just so he can sleep on the bed. Also, I woke up and at the foot of my bed, there was a computer desk. And at this computer desk, I saw a boy just standing there trying to reach up for something that was on the shelf above it. And I thought that was still in a dream haze. So what I did was I sat up and I blinked really heavily a few times and he was still there. But then he slowly disappeared. This is weird, admittedly. But it's also something that I've already explained. It could be sleep paralysis, it can be like a dream brain, like after effect kind of thing. But that's not the strange thing. The strange thing is that my friend who was sleeping next to me, he was awake and he said to me, "Did you just see that boy?" Still to this day, I have no explanation for that. The best examples of good evidence for ghost stories are those in which there are more than one witness who experience the same phenomenon. Like the boy at the computer desk, both me and my friend saw this ghostly apparition. The thing is, I had talked to my friend about what he had seen, but I made a very clear point of not talking to him about what I've seen until I heard his account, and they matched. And this is important. This is very important. Because a lot of the time when you're talking about a ghostly experience to someone, you'll often find that some are quick to collaborate their experiences with yours until you have a good story, so to speak. And this doesn't actually happen intentionally. Sometimes, or most of the time, it can happen unintentionally. You imprint an idea onto someone else, and they will return with a variation of their account. And you keep on backwards and forwards in this until the experience matches each other. As I said, this can be unintentional, and most of the time when I've seen this, it is unintentional. For me, this happened once. Maybe not backwards and forwards with the idea, but when I was with one of my exes, she lived in this really weird house. It was pretty big, it was epic, it had a huge gate. You open the gate and there's a driveway, you go and park in the driveway, and it was a detached house in the middle of nowhere. And the only building that was anywhere near hers was a restaurant that was next door, and it used to be an old schoolhouse, like in the Victorian times. And the story was that the house was haunted. Oh! And apparently so was the house that she lived in. And from day one, there were weird things that happened in that house. From day one. My ex started to have these really horrible dreams about the girl from the ring chasing her, but there was a slight variation of the girl from the ring. It was the girl from the ring with a fake cheesy plastic smile. And it used to be in every single dream. And she used to wake up and say, the girl from the ring was in my dream again. Just standing there. Sometimes it would be part of the plot and sometimes it would just be around, you know, which is creepy. It's like Dimitri Martin's clown theory, that clowns are scarier when one is just around. This is the same thing. The girl from the ring is scary when she's just not doing anything, just around. She kept on seeing things. Her sister kept on seeing things. Her mum and dad kept on seeing things. And the dogs, they kept on just getting up randomly, staring at something, barking. And you're like, what are you doing? Why are you running? You can kind of explain a lot of these with new house nerves, especially when this house is in the middle of nowhere. You need time to adapt to get used to the noises of the house. Otherwise, you're just hearing something that you're just not used to. Dogs can bark at things because there's not a lot of sound in the area. So when a sound does happen, it's like, what the hell is that? I need to bark at this, even if it's just something like a pigeon. You know, weird stuff happened all the time. Weird stuff happened all the time. And everyone had experienced something strange apart from me. I was the only person that hadn't seen or heard anything weird. But I'd heard everyone else's experience, and all of that had soaked into my brain. Until I remember one of the days where I was sitting on the toilet and I was doing a number two. Everybody poops. And then the door to the bathroom that I was in locked. I heard it. I heard the and I was like, okay, that's weird. And I assumed that I kind of half locked the door, or the door was half locked. And then when I closed it, a little gust of wind had fully closed the door, and then the lock kind of slid into place. And I thought that if that was the case, then that's quite lucky, because the key to the door is on the inside. And if I was on the outside and it had locked and I needed a number two, then there's no way I could get in. I would have to take the door off or go in the pantry. So I'm there carrying on my business. And then the door starts to shake really violently, and I shout for the person that's on the other side of the door. So I think someone's, you know, messing me around. But there was no one in the house but me, because everyone had decided to go out to do this thing and I had just remained indoors, probably because I needed to go to the toilet so bad. So I snap the log like it's the end of the Titanic. And I try and open the door, and it takes a few attempts, but I did manage to open the door. But before I managed to open the door, I could feel the door shaking in my hand, So when I eventually went to open the door, the shaking stopped. And I walked out the door, and I closed the door behind me, because I thought maybe there was some wind and it was kicking up a fuss, but there was nothing. There was just nothing there. And from that point, that's when I start to experience the dreams. I'm dreaming the same thing as everyone else. Girl from the ring with a fake plastic smile on her face. Admittedly, as I said before, I didn't really go backwards and forwards with this concept with my ex, but I'd heard so much about it that the idea, as I said, have soaked into my brain by now. Last thing about the house before I move on to something else. One of the experiences that was happening in the house was that there was the sound of footsteps, running, either through the corridor, but most importantly, up in the attic. And combined with one of those things, the other thing that people were experiencing were lights switching on. And I don't mean lights switching on, I mean the light switch switching on. So if the light had just come on, you could explain that with faulty wiring. But when you hear and then the light goes on, that's a little bit different. Normally it would happen when you're leaving a room. You would switch a light on, and as you go down the corridor a little bit, you hear a faint in the background. And then you go back into the room and you find that the light's on. You're like, okay, that's weird. Nobody ever saw it actually happen, but they could hear it. So they moved out the house, understandably, because they weren't comfortable in their own house. And as I am a house moving aficionado, I did one of the final sweeps of the house, checking to see if everything was right, if anybody had left anything, turn off all the lights, turn off all the taps, you know, things like that. And the last room that I checked was actually my ex's little sister's room. And at the time that she was at the house, she was always complaining about hearing footsteps in the attic, which we explained as rats or bats or something similar that just echoes through an attic, so it sounds quite bad. But the attic hatch, the entrance to the attic, was in her room, so she had freaked out all the time about hearing footsteps and imagining that there's something coming down the attic hatch, which again we explained with, you know, it's just rats or something. Every time she would hear a noise, she would go and grab someone to, like, the noise is happening now. And every time she did that, there was no noise. So everyone just assumed, yeah, it's rats. Bearing in mind that my ex's room shared the same kind of ceiling, so the attic space was, like, in her room as well. And she'd never heard anything either, and I never had. She's there moving out. I'm checking all the rooms, checking all the lights. I check behind her, her little sister's room, the door, to see if she left anything behind, and I switch off the light, and as I'm leaving, I hear footsteps above me. Boom, boom, boom. Boom, boom, boom. And the light goes back on, and I'm like a foot away from the light switch, but on the outside of the room. Now, occasionally, you have like a really horrible sensation that there's someone standing behind you. Like, if anybody's actually experienced sleep paralysis, you'll know that this fear is like, there's something in the room, like right now, kind of feeling. And I had that, and this was one of the biggest experiences for me. And I was facing out of the room with my back to the room, the doors open, and I feel like there's something behind me, like really close behind me. You know what I'm saying? Like really close. I take a step back, I switch off the light, and I leave without looking into the room. Yeah, I walk downstairs without looking into the room. I just don't look in the room. I get in the car, and someone says to me, "Giz, you've left the light on." And I look up, the light in the bedroom is on, and I say, "No, I didn't, let's just go." We left the house, and we've never seen it since. Or I haven't, at least. One explanation for ghosts is ultra-low frequencies. Infrasound is any noise which is too low for the ear to register as a sound. You can feel it, though. It affects you physically and affects you psychologically, but you're not able to register it as a note. So a lot of the times, it's invisible to you. And there's loads of different applications for this, like in medicine and stuff like that. However, recently it's been linked to ghost sightings. Vic Tandy experienced a ghost in his lab. I say Vic Tandy as if it's a guy. Might be Victoria. I'm gonna do gender neutral. They said, and I quote, "I was sweating, but cold. The feeling of depression was noticeable, but there was also something else. It was as though something was in the room with me." Then, in the corner of his eye, her eye, he or she saw a ghost developing the side of his or her vision. But when he or she turned to face the ghost, it had gone. He or she accidentally discovered that when polishing his or her fencing sword, they noticed that it was vibrating, even though it was clamped in a vise. He or she then theorized that there must be infrasound in the room causing the vibration of the fencing sword and causing the psychological effects of, like, you know, seeing a ghost, feeling of dread. And lo and behold, there was. And the highest concentration was at Vic's desk, where Vic had seen the ghost appear. Vic was then asked to research paranormal activity in both Warwick Castle and the basement of Coventry's Tourist Information Centre. Apparently, ghost hotspots, tourist information centres. Both these locations had high levels of infrasound and also high levels of ghost sightings. Research had shown that 19 Hertz is a sweet spot for physiological effects, including sense of fear and or dread. A good example is my gran. My gran is as tough as they come. She doesn't try to be tough, she just is. To prove it, my gran used to work in a building in which she had to do rounds at night, and there was this one particular corridor in the building that she had to work in which my gran just hated going down. She said every time that she would go down it, she would think that there was a goblin just about to jump out at her and land on her back. She hated the feeling, it was fearful, you know, dread and such. But because my gran is my gran, she would purposely go through the corridor, even though she's scared of it, without turning on the light, just to prove that there was nothing there. I'm telling you, my gran's tough. If infrasound can make my gran feel nervous, anything is possible. I had exactly the same feeling once. A few years ago, I got home quite late. I think it was like 4 o'clock in the morning. And when I got to the front door, I found that it was locked. and I couldn't get in because somebody had left their key on the inside of the lock. So when I put my key in, I couldn't turn it because it didn't do anything. So I decided to go for a walk that you guys have seen many times in some of my videos.
So I'm on this very familiar bit of land. It's a stretch of bit between the sea and the road and the train tracks. It's a cycle path. I've shot some of my favorite videos here, so hopefully this will follow suit with all the rest.
Hello! I made a crow fly away. Known as the Penzance cycle path. I don't really get scared of going through dark areas, similar to my gran. I just go for it, even if I feel a bit like, oh no, I shouldn't do this. I just do, because I don't think there's anything spooky on there. But on this occasion, I was freaked a little, and I still managed to walk down it. Now, bearing in mind, I'm very tired, I don't have my glasses on me, it's dark outside. Out the corners of my eyes, on the wall, I could see, like, this goblin. And it was like walking alongside the wall next to me, following my movement. It reminded me of a mix between Gollum and, you know, this thing from The Simpsons. It was creepy. The weird thing is, when I actually went to look directly at it, because I didn't have my glasses on, everything is kind of like the corner of my eye vision without my glasses. You know, it's slightly blurry. Like, I can't see the viewfinder in the camera without my glasses on. With my glasses, I can see that I'm wearing a Pentatonix t-shirt. So when I was looking straight at it, it didn't disappear. I could still see it, but just blurry. And that was creepy, and that was weird. I think that living in Cornwall, there are a lot of explanations about the ghost sightings. Cornwall is situated in the far southwest region of the UK, for those of you who don't know. And we're surrounded by the sea. North, south, west. The only bit that we're not surrounded by the sea is the bit that attaches us to the rest of the country. Although I don't have proof for this, I theorise the waves crashing on the coastline that surrounds Cornwall and the wind echoing through the old smuggling tunnels back when pirates were about creates the infrasound that's responsible for ghost sightings. Again, I have no proof, but a concentration of ghost sightings in Cornwall is really big. I've seen books dedicated to ghosts in Cornwall. So I think it might be infrasound that's creating that. But hey, that's just a theory.
A game theory!
And cut! In conclusion, I think that there's a lot of explanations for ghosts and most ghost sightings. Not all of them. Some of them, they make me think long and hard still.
Giggity giggity.
Take the example of the boy at the computer desk. Difficult to explain that one away. I also made a video recently about my creepiest ghost sighting, which I had, which I labelled as, you know, 1 in 1,000 ghost sightings are very difficult to explain, and this is my 1 in 1,000. It was very creepy, and it's the creepiest thing that I've probably ever experienced. So if you want to watch that, then there's a link somewhere. I don't know. And that's it for today. If you've had any ghostly experiences or ghostly apparitions or ghostly stuff, then let me know in the comments section below. If you have a theory on what the deal is with ghosts, then please let me know in the comments section below. Also, if you've had a really weird ghostly experience, I'd like to know exactly what that was. So until next time, bye! Yeah, that's right. I got two cameras today. Thank you everyone for being a Patreon supporter. These are the names of the executive producers who help really fund the show. There are many other names in the description box below, and thank you very much. If you want to see my last video, then click here, and don't forget to click that subscribe button with the bell. There's my channel. Just click it. Why not? Just click it. Bye.